Welcome to Father Matt's Bible Studies and Sermons podcast. My name is Matthew Mead. I'm the priest and rector at the Parish of Christ the Redeemer in Pelham, New York. In today's episode, we continue reading the book of Revelation, reading chapters 11, 12, 13, and 14. And we start by listening to a discussion by Professors Harry Attridge and David Bartlett from the Yale Bible Studies archive. God bless and hope you enjoy the Bible study. Let us pray. Almighty God, we ask your blessing on our Bible study today. We also ask your blessing on our senior lunch. May the weather continue to be beautiful as this day moves forward. All this we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Today, we are going to start with the video of what we read last week from chapters 11 and 12. And I think this will be incredibly informative. I watched this a week and a half ago, and I thought it was great. Harry Attridge does a wonderful job of really clarifying what's going on in these chapters. So I hope that you enjoy it, and it's coming up in 1 second.
The vision continues. More interesting symbolic figures. What do we have as we get into chapter 12? Who's this woman?
Yeah, this is, I think, in many ways, the central set of visions of the whole book, chapters 12 through 14, starting with the woman clothed with the sun.
Right.
We have seven of them. They're not numbered like the trumpets or the seals were in the previous chapters, but each of these visions begins with the same formula, "and I saw."
Yeah.
So the author is again thinking in terms of seven. And the first three visions, which occupy chapters 12 and 13, are all of the enemy, if you will.
Yeah.
And then the next visions are of the good guys.
Mm-hmm.
So let's think about the
bad guys.
The bad guys, yeah. Begin with. Well, the woman is actually a good gal.
Yeah.
And we have two important feminine images in the book. Actually, three. We have the woman clothed with the sun.
Right.
Who in some ways is the mother of the Messiah.
Yeah.
And we'll have to think a little bit more about that.
Yeah.
And then we have the whore of Babylon in chapter 17, and we'll have to think about that.
Yeah.
And then the bride of the Lamb
at the end.
Yeah. So there are these three very potent images that call on lots of symbolic traditions out of the Old Testament and out of contemporary mythology and art, for that matter. I think the woman clothed with the sun here, with the moon under her feet and on her head a crown of 12 stars, is an image that has been used in the Christian tradition for Mary, the mother of Jesus.
Yeah.
And it appears all over the place.
Yeah.
And I think we have some pictures in the written material here that illustrates that.
Yeah.
But in any case, the imagery, I think, is a little more complicated than just a depiction of the glorified Mary. This image of a cosmic presence comes out of Greco-Roman religion.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's referring to deities like Artemis, the mm-hmm. goddess of Ephesus, other Greco-Roman deities of one sort or another that had some sort of cosmic dimension. But this is being used of the mother of the Messiah in, I believe, a corporate sense rather than an individual sense. It's the people of Israel being depicted here, and I gather that from the way in which the mother and her child are persecuted by the great serpent chapter 13, verse 13. So what's depicted here at the beginning of chapter 12 is an ancient mythic paradigm or archetype of a woman, a pregnant woman and her child, a woman who has divine dimensions to her being threatened by some sort of inimical power of evil. There's a story told about Leto and her children, Apollo and Diana,
uh-huh.
of precisely this sort.
Yeah, here we are. Yeah, yeah.
So it's there in ancient mythology, and you could find parallels in ancient Near Eastern mythology, too, of Marduk and Tiamat, battles between some sort of serpent and some sort of power of good. So our author is conjuring up powerful imagery that could be read in a number of ways. He tells us how to read it, especially with the serpent that's threatening the woman and her child. The serpent is the ancient serpent, he says, mm-hmm. in verse 9.
Right.
The devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. Yeah. So it's clear that he's setting up a fundamental dichotomy between the forces of good and the forces of evil. Forces of good represented by mother and messianic child, and the forces of evil represented by Satan. The most important part of this image is, I think, in verse 9, that Satan has been thrown down. And this, again, conjures up all sorts of mythical combat imagery between good guys and bad guys. We're familiar with it in the West, St. George and the dragon,
right.
But it's a very widespread image. The key point here is that Satan has been thrown down to earth, been defeated in some way. He's down, but he's not out. That's important for the sequence.
Both sides of that are important.
That's right. And that victory has already been celebrated here in verse 10. So this picks up the celebratory note that we heard in at the end of chapter 11, that hallelujah chorus, right? And in chapter 12, verse 10, now have come the salvation and power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of the Messiah. For the accuser of our comrades, our brethren, has been thrown down. Again, there's a connection here between the experience of the community, the experience of persecution that we've talked about before, and this primordial myth. So that continues throughout chapter 12, the notion that there's a combat between these two forces, the fundamental forces.
So how does the heaven earth thing happen? Heavenly victory assured.
Earthly battle still going on, and we're going to see how that battle unfolds in chapter 13. Because we have here, as I said, in the first visions here in the sequence, a list of the enemy. And the first enemy is the devil, Satan, if you will. The next enemy in chapter 13, verses 1 through 10, is a beast from the sea. And remember where we are, theoretically, and seeing this vision. We're on the western coast of Asia Minor. And so the sea you're looking at is the Aegean. And what comes to you from over the sea is Roman imperial power. So it's pretty clear that what goes on with this beast from the sea is a notion that the forces of ultimate evil that have been described in the first vision are now embodied. They're incarnate in Rome. And it's a kind of bizarre image that we have here, a beast with 10 horns and 7 heads and 10 diadems on the horns. Attempts to portray this artistically are all very amusing. Very difficult to imagine. And then the beast is a composite of various kinds of animals, a leopard and a bear and a lion. So it's really a kind of postmodern, post-realist kind of thing, more than impressionism, cubism, if you will. All of this imagery is coming from Daniel. And in Daniel chapter 7, before we get to the image of the one like a son of man, we have images of various imperial powers that had impressed Israel of old. And they're all depicted as beasts. All of those beasts are amalgamated here into one beast that is Rome. And the beast has, according to verse 5, a mouth that utters haughty and blasphemous words and is allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. This is the same limited period of time, the time, two times and half a time, 3.5 years on a lunar calendar that was referred to back there in chapter 11. So the authority of this beast is for a limited period, is what the author is saying, alluding again to Daniel.
Patriotic slogans or imperial praises?
Probably, or, yes. It opened its mouth to utter blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is those who dwell in heaven, by identifying itself with heavenly power.
I think that's what's
going on. And it's clearly Roman imperial power that's referred to. It has authority over every tribe and people and language and nation and all the inhabitants of the earth. Okay?
Very good.
And then there's a little poetic tag at the end of this, which is a message to those who resist or stand in confrontation with this power. Let anyone who has an ear listen. If you are to be taken captive, into captivity you will go. Mm-hmm. If you kill with the sword you must be killed.
Yeah.
I think this is a call to passive resistance.
I do too,
It's a call not to take up the sword, as did the revolutionaries against Rome back in the 60s.
Yeah.
It's a call to bear witness, and if you have to suffer for it, fine. But don't take up the sword.
And then, as we saw at the very beginning, the suffering is his own victory.
That's right. That's right.
Paradoxical.
It's a share in the victory won by the slain lamb.
Yeah, 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 exactly.
Okay, so that's the second vision, and the beast from the sea.
Then
and then there's a third
beast.
Vision.
Yeah.
I saw... Again, in chapter 13, verse 11, and this is a beast that comes out of the earth. And it mimics the other beasts. It has two horns, like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. So it has features of both positive and negative animals
figures
that we've seen.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And it exercises the authority of the first beast on its behalf. So what's going on here? I think what we're talking about is the aristocracy of the cities of Asia Minor.
Uh-huh.
And we know from historical sources that there was a competition to observe the rites of Roman religion, to be custodians of the temple of Rome and Caesar among some of these cities.
Right.
The ruling classes of this area bought into the imperial system, and they found it to be a source of peace and prosperity for themselves. And so I think that's what's being referred to here, their buy-in to the imperial system.
Well, we need to circle back for just a minute to say something about the number of the beast.
The number of the beast, yes.
Much used.
Right, we're going to be coming up to that number at the end of the chapter. Chapter 13, verse 18.
Yeah.
And this is tied in with the way in which this beast from the land exercises its authority on behalf of the Roman imperial power.
Yeah, yeah.
And it does two things.
Okay.
It enforces worship of the first beast, the Roman imperial power. And that's what we hear in verses 14. It deceives the inhabitants of the earth, telling them to make an image for the beast, that is, the beast from the sea, that had been wounded by the sword and yet lived. This is an allusion, I think, to the assassination of Nero in 68.
Okay.
We're going to be hearing about that again in chapter 17.
Right.
And there's also an allusion here to what goes on in some aspects of pagan cult in verse 15. It, that is, the beast from the land, was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast so that the image of the beast could speak. We have reports from a second century satirist named Lucian about a false prophet named Alexander of Abinitikos who had a serpent, a puppet, that he used to give voice to divine proclamations. This is an allusion to precisely
that kind of
thing. So the author is alluding to the kinds of cultic activity that went on in his environment. This beast here from the land causes worship of the enforces worship of the beast from the sea, and for those who don't worship the beast from the sea, they get killed.
Yeah,
according to verse 15.
Yep.
So this is where the persecution is coming from,
absolutely,
that the author has been referring to on numerous occasions.
Yeah.
There's another thing that the author says, though. All right, so there's idolatry going on.
Yeah.
There's false worship, and he wants to preserve his community from that. But there's also some sort of economic oppression.
Yeah,
and he's very clever about how this works. Verse 16 and following.
Right.
It, the beast from the land, causes all, both great and small, rich and poor, slave and free. Sounds an awful lot like Galatians 3:28 and the way in which the community of early Christians is defined.
Yeah, yeah.
Causes these people to be marked on the right hand and the forehead. They're marked in a way that parodies the sealing or marking of the 144,000 back in chapter 7.
Where they're anointing.
And it also parodies or is kind of a diabolic equivalent of how Orthodox Jews would mark themselves at time of prayer by putting phylacteries to fill in on their arms and on their foreheads. So this is the diabolic equivalent of Orthodox worship
in various ways.
But how does that happen? Are people actually putting on tefillin? I don't think so. And the author gives us a hint here. This calls for wisdom. Let anyone with understanding calculate the number of the beast. And you have to go back to the beginning of verse 17 to get what he's talking about. When you do all of this marking, you then can buy and sell. If you don't have the mark, you can't buy and sell. What's he talking about? Is it a physical mark here? Or is it what you get on coins with which you buy and sell?
Yeah.
I think you see he's referring here in the with the parody of tefillin to good luck gestures, like looking at a coin on your head, flipping a coin, holding a coin to your forehead and saying, you know, God be with us or something. So there's some sort of parody going on that that appeals to local custom, all having to do with a coin. And on the coin, you get the image of the beast and you get the name of the beast.
Yeah.
And what the author is doing here in 13:18 is referring to the fact that in Greek and in Hebrew, you refer to numbers with letters of the alphabet.
Right.
And so any name will have a numerical equivalent, and you can play guessing games.
Yeah.
And so he says, I'm thinking of a name, and it has the numerical equivalent of 666.
Yeah.
What is that? It's probably Nero Caesar in Hebrew.
Yeah.
That's
that
works.
Good.
And Nero, of course, has been alluded to with a wound that has been inflicted on the beast, the wound that was healed.
Yeah.
So I think we have simply an allusion to
Nero
as the archetypical Roman emperor. Whether he's the actual Roman emperor is another matter.
So 14, are we getting hope again?
Yeah, judgment 14 again? And going into 15, we have the good guys lined up.
Yeah.
Very quickly in 14, we have the Lamb. We've heard about the Lamb before, and he's standing on Mount Zion, and he's surrounded by angels. And the angels, among other things, give their positive messages about preservation of those who are in the Lamb's camp.
Right.
They also sound a new note here in chapter 14, verse 8. That is, fallen is Babylon the Great.
Yeah.
Announcing as a fait accompli something that might be a hope, either an eschatological hope or a short-time political hope.
Or both.
They announce it here.
Yeah.
And that theme is then going to carry through the next several chapters. The celebration of the fall of Babylon, which hasn't taken place yet.
Right.
Okay.
Terrific.
Okay. So there we are, and then we have the rest for their labors that's proclaimed for those who follow in the footsteps of the Lamb. The victory seems to be won or half won.
Yeah, one foot,
little bit ambiguous, isn't it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. We'll carry on with the next chapter in a few minutes.
All right, any questions or comments on that? We're going to read what they talked about, so some of that is new.
If it, when you come to it, the whole bit about the numeric equivalent to the alphabet and all that.
Sure, yep, we'll get to that. That's in what we're going to read today. So we will get to that and have a better understanding of it. Okay, let me look for one thing online. There we go. Okay. Great. Okay. Share. All right. We're going to start where we left off last time. Can you see my screen? I hope. Okay. So last time we read 11 and 12, and this section starts with 12, which we have read, but just as a quick review, it's seven visions. They're not called seven visions, but it happens seven times that either he sees a great sign or a great portent in heaven, Or he simply says, I see, or I saw. And if you count them as we go, they number up to seven. The first one is the woman and the dragon, which we read about last week. The second one is the next chapter, and that is the beast that they were talking about. So number two, and I saw, right? So who would like to read? Who's up first? I can see that Charlotte is there, but I do not see Charlotte. Charlotte, are you there?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Can you read this?
Yes. Okay. And I saw a beast rising out of the sea with 10 horns and 7 heads.
Oops. Sorry. Hold on. I got to fix one thing.
Okay.
All right. There you go. That's going to probably be a little better. Yeah. Okay.
Okay. With 10 horns and 7 heads. And in its horns were 10 diadems. And on its heads were blasphemous names. Names. And the beast that I saw was like a leopard. Its feet were like a bear's, and its mouth was like a lion's mouth. And the dragon gave it his power and his throne and great authority. One of its heads seemed to have received a death blow, but its fatal wound had been healed. In amazement, the whole earth followed the beast. They worshiped the dragon, for he had given his authority to the beast. And they worshiped the beast, saying, "Who is like the beast, and who can fight against it?" The beast was given a mouth, speaking arrogant and blasphemous words, and it was allowed to exercise authority for 42 months. It opened its mouth to speak blasphemies against God, blaspheming his name and his dwelling, that is, those who dwell in heaven. Also, it was allowed to wage war on the saints and to conquer them. It was given authority over every tribe and people and language and nation, and all the inhabitants of the earth will worship it. Everyone whose name has not been written from the foundation of the world in the book of life, let everyone who has an ear listen. If you are to be taken captive, into captivity you go. If you kill with the sword you must be killed. Here is a call for the endurance and faith of the saints.
Okay, great. Thank you. Professor Attridge talked about this in some detail, but I will highlight what he said and say a little bit more. So we're in Asia Minor, aka modern Turkey. And the sea that is next to that is the Aegean Sea, and across from it is Greece and Rome. That's an image to Rome, but there's a few more. If you know Rome, there's seven. It's famous for having seven hills. And a lot of people will do the math. And at this point, there's probably been 10 emperors. So that's probably what you get in terms of 10 horns, which if you remember, Daniel, the horns were generally reserved for a king or an emperor, were identified as a horn because a horn is some sort of power figure. And the heads may or may not, but probably do reference the seven hills of Rome for which it was known. Blasphemous names are probably the fact that the emperors started referring to themselves as gods. It could also refer to the Roman pantheon of gods and goddesses. As Professor Attridge said, our beast is an amalgamation of the beasts from Daniel that made up the various visions. If you go back into Daniel that we read a couple of months back, you will find leopard, bear, lion, that sort of thing. And this is an amalgamation of all of that. And it is given, the beast is given the power of Satan. If you remember from the last chapter, the dragon is Satan. And so it's, you know, Rome is the evil Satan incarnate in the world, so to speak. One of the heads seems to have received a death blow. This may be a reference to an assassination attempt or something, but that that didn't kill off the empire. I believe Nero was assassinated, so this might be right after that. There were other assassinations in history too, but it didn't take, so to speak. The whole earth follows the beast, and they worship the dragon, aka Satan, through the beast. And people eventually say, basically, who can give up, who can fight the beast because the beast is too powerful. Does that all make some sense about the references back to Rome and what's going on? We get more Daniel references here. If you remember, arrogant, there was constantly an arrogant horn or an arrogant mouth in Daniel that usually referred to Antiochus the fourth, and that he was arrogant and spoke blasphemous words. Likewise, our beast here is speaking arrogant and blasphemous words. And likewise, our beast here, just like Antiochus Epiphanes, is given authority for 42 months or 3.5 years or however many days it is. So these references are taken right out of Daniel. And the idea is that for a not forever time, this beast is going to have authority, but this will end. And I would say probably the reference to Daniel is that they knew pretty well that these periods of times in Daniel were not exact, and that you know, they had never really gotten control back. So they're referencing something that already was a prophecy that didn't work out exactly as it was supposed to, but it's still maintaining that this period of time will not last forever and will eventually end. The beast continues to speak blasphemies against God and his name, and wages war on the saints and everybody on earth. And then eventually it gets to the end here, which Professor Attridge described nicely, which is that you will suffer during this, but suffer passively. If you're taken captive, go into captivity. If you try to kill with the sword, then you're going to die. So have faith and have endurance. Any comments or questions on that? Revelation is interesting. All right. The second beast, right? Now we're on our third vision, right? Then I saw. Sherry, do you want to read this?
Then I saw another beast that rose out of the earth. It had two horns like a lamb, and it spoke like a dragon. It exercises all the authority of the first beast on its behalf, and it makes the earth and its inhabitants worship the first beast, whose fatal wound had been healed. It performs great signs, even making fire come down from heaven to earth in sight of all. And by the signs that it is allowed to perform on behalf of the beast, it deceives the inhabitants of earth, telling them to make an image for the beast that had been wounded by the sword and yet lived, and it was allowed to give breath to the image of the beast, so that the image of the beast could even speak and cause those who would not worship the image of the beast to be killed. Also, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be given a brand on the right hand or the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell who does not have the brand, that is, the name of the beast or the number for its name. This calls for wisdom. Let anyone with understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number for a person. Its number is 666.
Great. Okay. A couple of things in here. First, we've got, this is our third vision. It's another beast. It's a smaller beast. It has two horns, which probably means there are two governors or two somethings. But it too speaks like the dragon. And if you remember, the dragon is Satan. So it's another link back, but it's exercising authority on behalf of our first beast. As Professor Attridge said, most scholars will tell you that this is probably local, Asia Minor governorships that are forcing people to do to worship the beast. I think it was in the last video that he talked about this, but there's a very famous letter from a governor in this area named Pliny, and he writes back to Trajan the emperor and says, "We've got a problem with Christians, and people are accusing people of Christians, and what am I supposed to do? It doesn't seem like they're doing all that much, but if they refuse to worship the emperor, we've been killing them." And Trajan says, yeah, this is fine. Whatever you're doing, keep doing, but don't seek them out and don't get into a situation where people are making hay over Christians, so to speak. If they show up and they refuse to worship, then yes, kill them. So you have a literal example in a letter from this governor to an emperor that deals with this exact sort of things. Another portion of this is economical, and I'll get to that in a second, but this whole section from "It Performs Great Signs," Professor Attridge talked a bit about this. It looks, if you read it sort of with this in mind, it looks similar to the kind of magical tricks that you saw in Exodus between Pharaoh's magicians, and I think they're called that, and Moses, where Moses does a real sign and Pharaoh's magicians, do smoke and mirrors things. This looks sort of like that, making fire come down from heaven, signs that are performed on behalf of the beast to deceive people, and telling them that, there's this beast that can talk with breath in it and what have you, which may be a puppet, like he says. But in any event, it's signs to make people follow the beast. And it's linked not just to worshiping the emperor, but it's linked also to you do not get to participate in the economy if you're not part of this. And if you've ever been to Rome or anywhere like that, the economy and the religion are all kind of intermingled. The temples are in the forum are all kind of on top of each other. So it's not like it would be that difficult to imagine participating in the cult equals participating in the economy and back and vice versa. Before I get to the mark, any questions on that? Okay. Phylacteries. They mentioned that. You know what these are if you've been to Israel and been to the wall, the Western Wall, you know what they are. Here is a picture of a man with phylacteries on his head and on his arm, right? You've probably seen these in New York as well. This is straight out of Deuteronomy, and it is wear it on your arm, wear the word of the Lord on your arm and on your forehead. And it's, I believe it's the Shema, which is the Lord your God is one, that line. And that inside of written on this is text, and in here is a piece of a scroll put up against the forehead. So when Professor Attridge talks about parodying this, there it is. This is actually a very good thing. Phylacteries, called tefillin in Hebrew, are worn by observant Jewish men each weekday morning during prayer. Two small leather boxes contain verses from the first books of the Bible. Boxes are attached to the leather straps, one tied to the arm, see the box, and the other placed on the head, worn as a reminder of God and to follow Jewish law daily, removed at conclusion of morning prayer services. So when we get into this, and the mark that was on the 144,000, the mark on the 144,000 is probably a positive follow-up, not a parody, of the phylacteries. And this is a negative, Professor Attridge said, demonic or satanic parody of the phylacteries. And it's not exactly clear what they're doing, but the beast causes all. And I will reiterate what he said. This is almost straight out of Galatians, if you remember Galatians. Small and great, rich and poor, slave and free, we're all one in Christ, right? You probably remember that. All are given a brand on the right hand or on the forehead, so that you can't buy or sell if you don't have the brand. And Professor Attridge thinks that it has something to do with money and coins. I would say he's probably right. I don't know exactly what the customs were or not. It is possible that they were literally making fun of observant Jews with their phylacteries and, putting money on their foreheads and on their arms. It's possible that there was some other local custom. Whatever they have has the name and the number of the beast. And when you calculate that number, you apparently get the person, and it tells us this. This is not all that codey, right? Let anyone with understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it's the number of a person. So the question is how does 666 equal a name of a person, or specifically Nero Caesar in Hebrew? And in Greek and in Hebrew, when so we're all familiar with Roman numerals, right? I is 3, right? IV is 4. If you followed golf at all, LIV is what? It's 54, right? Four. Which is, they play 54 holes. Get it? Like, that's what Roman numerals are. Greek and Hebrew do not have numerals. So in Greek and in Hebrew, and I know Greek better, so 1, 2, 3, 4 is alpha, beta, gamma, delta, right? If you see a capital A, a capital alpha, and it's in the context of, you would be supplying a number here, it's a 1. Beta is a 2. Gamma is a 3. Delta is a 4. Epsilon is a 5. Eta is a 6, and so on down the line. And if you begin to look at, if you know that, and then you begin to look at different names, so, and it's impossible to do this in English, but Nero would be an N, would be some number, and then E would be some number, and then R would be some number, and you'd add them up. And you get, when you add them all up, you get 666. And apparently, and I don't know Hebrew well enough to do this, but apparently if you add up the numbers based on the letters of Nero Caesar, it adds up to 666. Does that make sense? There's a certain amount of, you'll have to trust me on that, but I do know that the example between Roman numerals and Greek numerals is radically different. So when you're dealing with numbers in Greek or Hebrew, they never came up with different numbers. So each number of the alphabet, each letter of the alphabet is its own number. And in the Greek, for what this is worth, it's spelled out here. It's not, there's two ways to do number. You can spell out the number, or you can give a digit. And this is spelled out. And actually the translation is brilliant. If it was digits, it would be the numbers 666. But in Greek, it's actually spelled out. So they never even give you the first part of the code, which is kind of funny. I bet if you Google 666, you'll find all sorts of craziness. But you also might find, if you Google calculate 666 Nero, and we'll do that right now and see what happens. One wonders, calculate 666 Nero.
I have a book on Revelations, and it actually tells you exactly. So it says, most
there it is.
Be Nero. Right. So it says N is 50, R is 200, O is 6, N is 50, Q is 100, S is 60, and R is 200. So it adds up to 666.
Right. So does that make, this is it right here. Does this make sense? This is even easier. Right.
There you go. There you go. Yep.
These are Hebrew letters. And my Hebrew is terrible, but it's Nun, Resh, Wa, Nun, right? And that's Nero, which is not the same in Hebrew and English. I mean, obviously, right? And this is Caesar, apparently. And so that's how it adds up. Does this help right here? Yeah. So each of these letters, get it? Like, this letter is 200. This letter is 50, right? This letter, which is much lower in the alphabet, is 6. So as you go up in terms of that, I don't remember where it switches, but I think it switches at 10. So you get 1 through 10, and then 20, you know, or something like that, or 50 or 100, 200, so that you can keep adding it up as you go down the alphabet. And it's just a different way of counting than Roman numerals. And Roman numerals are in part brilliant because it moves away from this and avoids a lot of the confusion. But if you do remember, Roman numerals still use letters, right? They just mean different things. They still use letters. And it's, I think it comes from Arabic that we have our actual digits.
Indo-Arabic.
Indo-Arabic.
Is what they call it.
So, yeah.
The interesting thing is the numbers in modern Hebrew today sound very much like the same numbers in Arabic.
Here's an example of the coin, right? The coin would say Nero, Caesar, Augustus. I mean, as soon as this is written, people are probably asking, John, so who is it? But, you know, eventually it becomes pretty obvious that this is who you link it to. And even way back, they knew that it was probably linking to Nero Caesar. I'm sure that there's other people you can get it to, but the calculating is fairly straightforward with these numbers. All right. Any questions on that?
So why do we think of it as Satan and the devil as opposed to Nero? Why hasn't this been explained? Immediately saying the beast is Satan and 666 is Satan and the devil.
It's the number of the beast and the beast. If you just keep going backwards, it's the number of the beast. This is the smaller beast who's forcing people to wear the number of the bigger beast, and the smaller beast speaks like the dragon. And if you go up, the bigger beast is given authority from the dragon. So it's because it all goes back to Satan. And if you go back one chapter, it's somewhere it identifies there, right there, right? The dragon is called the devil and Satan. That's that. So it just goes backwards. So you've got three levels. You've got a heavenly level or a hell level or whatever it is. And the dragon is there and the dragon is thrown down to earth. And then on behalf of the dragon, the first beast, which is Rome across the sea, is exercising authority across the whole world. And then locally, the second beast is exercising authority on behalf of the first beast, which is on behalf of the dragon. And so the mark of the beast is identifying a worldly leader who is operating on behalf of Satan in this example. Does that make sense? As much sense as Revelation makes. Okay. Let's keep going, I think. Or I don't know. Do we want to keep going? Yeah, we'll keep going. This is 14. Let's see how far we can get in this. James, can you read this right here?
Yes, certainly. Then I looked, and there was the Lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him were 144,000 who had his name and his father's name written on their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, like the sound of many waters and like the sound of loud thunder. The voice I heard was like the sound of harpists playing on their harps. And they sing a new song before the throne and before the four living creatures and before the elders. No one could learn that song except the 144,000 who have been redeemed from the earth. It is these who have not defiled themselves with women, for they are virgins. These follow the Lamb wherever he goes. They have been redeemed from mankind as first fruits of God and the Lamb, and in their mouth no lie was found. They are blameless.
Great. Okay, so our fourth vision switches to positive. And it's the Lamb on Mount Zion. That's fairly straightforward. Our 144,000 make a reappearance. They have what's correct written on their heads, which is the Father's name and the Lamb's name. And they sound like harps. I think that's interesting. I do find it very humorous that in Revelation is an example of a song that nobody can learn except for the 144,000, which reminds me occasionally of hymns that nobody can figure out that we sing. and that sort of thing. But the 144,000, I think it's worth noting here, their first fruits, in this case, they're all virgins in this case too. They all seem to be men, for what that's worth. I'm not sure if anybody caught that, based on this little thing. In any event, their first fruits, not the only one, and that follows up with what we saw earlier, where there's an initial group that are already saved, and then there's others that are from every nation and tribe around in every language that will join them. Any comments on this? All right. Let's see. Patrice, I don't think you've read. Can you read the message of the three angels?
Then I saw another angel flying in mid-heaven with an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who live on the earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. He said in a loud voice, "Fear God and give him glory, for the hour of his judgment has come, and worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water." Then another angel, a second, followed, saying, "Fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. She has made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her prostitution." Then another angel, a third, followed them, crying with a loud voice, "Those who worship the beast and its image and receive the brand on their foreheads or on their hands, they will also drink the wine of God's wrath, poured unmixed into the cup of his anger. And they will be tormented with fire and sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment goes up forever and ever. There is no rest day or night for those who worship the beast and its image and for anyone who receives the brand of its name. Here is a call for the endurance of the saints, those who keep the commandments of God and hold fast to the faith of Jesus. And I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this, blessed are the dead who from now on die in the Lord. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them.
Okay, so this is our fifth vision, and it's basically positive. It's a message for faithful people, essentially, or people that are on the fence, I think. And occasionally in Revelation, interestingly, like in the letters, the whole content of every letter is, what does this mean for you as a Christian in whatever community you are? Revelation is very rarely like that. It's all these big visions, and then occasionally you get the what does this mean for you today as a Christian, 2,000 years ago or even today. And we saw it in the last chapter, right? If you're persecuted, be pacifist. And here's another one, right? Fear God in all of this. Don't give in to the pressure of the beast and its worship and its economy and that sort of thing. Stay faithful and have endurance and keep the faith. And then this pretty famous thing that's in our burial rite, actually. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Yes, they will rest from their labors, for the deeds, their deeds follow them. If you get buried in the Episcopal Church, this is read at your funeral. But it's three different angels. Again, the numbers continue to be three or seven. For the most part, this is a message to people that are reading this, as opposed to a straight up vision. And I think it's fairly straightforward. Any questions on this chunk? Okay. Albin, can you read the last bit, reaping the earth's harvest? Gotta unmute.
Then I looked, and there was a white cloud, and seated on the cloud was one like the Son of Man, with a golden crown on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Another angel came out of the temple, calling with a loud voice to the one who sat on the cloud, "Use your sickle and reap, for the hour to reap has come, because the harvest of the earth is fully ripe. So the one who sat on the cloud swung his sickle over the earth, and the earth was reaped. Then another angel came out of the temple in heaven, and he too had a sharp sickle. Then another angel came out from the altar, the angel who had authority over fire, and he called with a loud voice to him who had the sharp sickle, "Use your sharp sickle and gather the cluster of the vine of the earth, for its grapes are ripe." So the angel swung his sickle over the earth and gathered the vintage of the earth, and he threw it into the great winepress of the wrath of God. And the winepress was trodden outside the city, and blood flowed from the winepress as high as a horse bridle, for a distance of about 1,600 stadia.
Great. Okay. Again, we have three angels. This is our sixth vision. I think this is the sixth vision. And then I looked, and if you on each one of them, then I looked and I saw, that kind of thing. This time the Son of Man is there. And if you remember your gospel narratives, one of the images of the Son of Man that Jesus uses pretty regularly, especially at the end of the gospel, is the Son of Man comes in judgment and comes on the clouds in judgment. And the Son of Man is the one that judges. And when you get that image, you're followed in the Gospels by a number of parables about things that are different images of separating things, harvests, right? There is literally a parable that matches this, that there is a harvest and the angels go out and reap the harvest and they burn the chaff and they keep the grain, right? And this literally shows up, right? There's an angel with fire and there's an angel with a sickle and they go out and do this. There are also other parables that you probably know pretty well that illustrate this in other ways. One of the more famous ones is the sheep and the goats, right? When the sheep are the ones that whenever you did this on behalf of Jesus, to the least of these, you did it to Jesus. Whenever you didn't do it to Jesus, right? If you fed somebody or didn't feed somebody, if you visited somebody or didn't visit somebody in prison. So there's a number of images about that. But this is, I would say this is very clearly written in familiarity with the teachings of Jesus and probably having one of the Gospels, possibly Mark, right in front, because this is all right out of the Gospels, this whole image of the Son of Man as the judge coming on the clouds, and even the harvest and that sort of thing. There's a famous book that you probably know by John Steinbeck. Anybody know what that reference comes from, right? The Grapes of Wrath, things like that. I don't know off the top of my head if I do know off the top of my head that the harvest imagery comes from prophets as well as Jesus. I don't know off the top of my head, but I would guess that this is an image that predates Revelation and comes out of the prophets as well. And I will try to look that up next time. And it would not, to me, this sounds very similar. Blood flowing from the wine press as high as a horse's bridle sounds very similar to some of the stuff you see at the end of Ezekiel, where water is flowing out of the temple and it gets higher and higher and higher and covers the whole earth. This seems to be, to me, a sort of play off of that. That's the wrath of God, as opposed to in Ezekiel, it's the worship of God spreading across the whole earth. In this case, it's the wrath of God spreading across the whole earth. And I will look up, or you're welcome to look up online, the 1,600 stadia. I don't know exactly what that is off the top of my head, but I'm sure there's a note in some Bibles that tells us. Anyway, any questions on this? All right, let me stop sharing. Next chapter, which we're not going to read right now, this is our seventh vision. Then I saw another portent. So that finishes off the visions. We will not do that today. What we will do, we have one class left before the summer. And so next class, we will finish off the seventh vision, which will, I'm assuming, start off another round of seven anyway. So we'll try to at least finish that, or at least find a place to pause. And we will also watch from the Bible Project, if you remember that, that's that cartoon thing. They will give a, or somewhat animated thing, they will give a very nice overview from start to finish of everything we have read. And I think that will be very helpful to get all of this in one kind of overarching chunk. And for the most part, they're fine. I prefer the Yale people, but the Bible study, the Bible Project people are pretty good on this too. Any questions or comments on Revelation so far? So our plan is we'll have gotten a little more than halfway through the book by next time, and we'll take a break and after the next class, we'll take a break and resume probably in September and finish off the book. Okay. So my hope is that everybody that's here will resurface in September. Otherwise, we'll have to wonder what happened to you. So I'll talk to you later. Hopefully I'll see all of you or most of you at the seniors lunch today. Okay?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye. Thank you for listening today. If you are interested in subscribing, please do on our podcast. And you can also find all of our Bible studies and other church videos on our YouTube page at youtube.com/C/Christ Church Pelham. You can just look for it. Christ Church Pelham on YouTube. God bless and take care.